Larry, thanks very much. Tonight's stunning news from the Gulf. The Coast Guard saying it can't find much more oil to collect. With hundreds of boats in the water yesterday, they say they only recovered one barrel's worth of oil. One barrel. So where is the oil? Are the dispersants and Mother Nature breaking it up faster than anyone thought? We'll have details in a moment. We begin, though, with BP, keeping them honest. Not a good day for the company. Big losses announced, $17 billion in the past quarter alone. Now, the company has a new CEO, Bob Dudley, who promises to learn from the spill. But the old CEO, Tony Hayward, apparently hasn't learned much. He got his life back and more than $18 million in severance. But he complains he was demonized in America and said in a conference call, quote, BP's response to this tragedy has been a model of good social corporate responsibility. It has mounted an unprecedented response. Well, the response was unprecedented, but of course, so was the size of the spill, so that's not saying very much. But claiming that BP has been a model of good corporate social responsibility, well, that just seems to fly in the face of the facts. Let's take a look over here at the wall at just a couple of examples. We kind of picked these frankly randomly. There's a lot more. Now, for weeks, BP underestimated the flow rate of oil, the amount of oil pouring out of that well. They said it was 1,000 barrels early on. That's what they claimed. They then reluctantly raised it to 5,000. Then they stuck with that number way after independent scientists said it could be as high as 70,000. And though early on they could have helped scientists measure the flow, they chose not to. Does that sound like a model of social corporate responsibility? Now, even this video, which we only got to see because members of Congress pressured them to release it, they had it for weeks before we got to see it live. Does that sound like a model of social responsibility? BP said they were taking responsibility for the cleanup, but at the same time, they were pointing fingers at others for the accident. Take a look at this. This is a Tony Hayward, May 3rd, said, this was not our drilling rig. It was not our equipment. It was not our systems, our people, or our processes. This was Transocean's rig, their systems, their people, their equipment. We've now heard a number of people testifying under oath to Congress and to other places that BP had a problem with its culture of safety. Allegations BP demanded workers on the rig get back on schedule, even at the cost of safety. Does that sound like a model of social responsibility? Now, just this weekend, Ken Feinberg, who's the man now in charge of the $20 billion compensation fund, he said that BP is stalling on payments to people in the Gulf and has not yet deposited any money in that $20 billion fund. They spend an estimated $50 million on these ads like these, and they give Tony Hayward more than $18 million as a goodbye present, and yet the victims of the spill are still waiting for money to pay their rent, their mortgages, their bills. Does that sound like a model of social responsibility? Tony Hayward, this is what he said today. He said, life isn't fair. Sometimes you step off the payment and get hit by a bus. He was talking about what happened to him and his career. This is certainly a lesson, though, the people in the Gulf already know. Life isn't fair. Sometimes you step off the payment and get hit by a bus, or sometimes you wake up and a model of social responsibility dumps oil all over your front yard. Joining us now is St. Bernard Parish President Craig DeFaro Jr., also to talk about the shifting nature of the spill and where the oil is or isn't, Ed Overton, Professor Emeritus of Environmental Studies at Louisiana State University. Ed, a Coast Guard official says the oil is in its final life cycle, that they aren't finding much oil on the surface, they say. Does this mean that it's gone? I mean, has Mother Nature and the dispersants just broken it up already?
Well, to a large extent. Remember, the spill stopped about 10 days ago. So, and the Gulf was really acclimated to taking 60,000 barrels a day. So all of a sudden you have none, the bacteria there, and they are degrading, very rapidly degrading what's left. So the amount of oil floating around in the Gulf is going down significantly. That doesn't mean that we're out of the woods. Oil will still be coming ashore for several more weeks, maybe several more months, but it is being degraded fairly quickly, as is seen by overflights.
So, Ed, if it means it's not on the surface, I mean, is there still all that oil in the water column that just diffused?
Well, I suspect that a lot of this oil is floating near the surface, but right under the water column. The oil that's easy to see that forms the sheen, that's been degraded. So the sheenable oil is gone, and what you've got is globs of oil floating near the surface, just under the surface, hard to see from the air, but it's still there. The tropical weather, I think, broke these globs of oil into much smaller droplets, and the smaller the droplets, the easier it is for the bacteria to degrade it. So we're clearly on the downhill slope on this thing. We're not at the end yet, but we can see the light at the end of the tunnel, I think.
Craig, are you worried? Are you skeptical that the threat has diminished? I mean, are you worried that they're going to start pulling out equipment?
That's exactly what we're seeing now, Anderson. The real concern is that You know, when you hear the description and the depiction of how much oil is really left, we've become somewhat desensitized, really. Think about if any amount of oil was discovered without this spill incident being part of it. There would be a response immediately to an environmental hazard. But for some reason, because the numbers are much higher, and now the well is capped, and by the way, we are very happy about that. We're ecstatic that the well is no longer leaking. But we cannot turn our eyes away from what's in the water. We're finding new oil every day. Whether the Coast Guard sees it, whether BP sees it, or anyone else, we go by what we experience every single day. We're having new oil impact on our marshlands, on our islands, and certainly within our skimming vessels.
Ed, at this point, do we know the impact? I mean, can we judge this with some perspective now, the impact this has had, will have on animal life, fish life, marine life, on the oyster beds? I mean, do we know what's happening underneath the water?
Well, we know that the oil is going away. Now, it's still there, as Craig pointed out, and it's still going to be coming ashore for a while. But the frequency, the quantity, will start falling off fairly dramatically. Now, we sure don't need to move the skimmers. We need to be prepared to get it off, because that's where the damage occurs, when it gets on shore. It's hard to tell what the damage is offshore. There's been any number of estimates. Of course, we can see the porpoises that are dead. The turtles have been counted. The birds, all of these things, but those kills will start dropping off fairly dramatically in the near future. The unseen damage is what will be hard to quantitate, and we don't know, and we may not know for a couple of years just how much damage is done to the total ecosystem.
So, Ed, I have no doubt that some then are going to hear, well, okay, they had 800 skimmers out, and we're only able to collect one barrel of oil yesterday. Some folks are going to say, well, look, this thing has been overblown. Has it been? I mean, was this as bad as scientists said it was or going to be early on?
Well, oil spills are acute events. That means that they're just horrible when they're occurring. But the long-term prognosis is a lot better than a lot of people have said. I mean, the past experience with Ixtoc and Exxon Valdez and all the other spills around the world show that it's a horrible acute event, and you've avidly demonstrated how ugly an oil spill is. But the long-term prognosis is not nearly as bad as some people have said. I think we'll be pretty much back to normal in 2 to 3 years. There will be some environmental indicators that won't come back for some time. But most, 90%, 90+% will return to normal fairly quickly. And I think next summer we'll have a hard time finding a lot of this oil. We'll still not the oyster bed, maybe some of the shrimp will not be back to normal. But in general, our environment will recover. It's amazing how resilient the environment is.
But you're saying oyster beds 2 to 3 years, some of them still will not be back to normal.
Well, I think that's the life cycle of going from spuds up to commercial harvest. I suspect that a lot of the oysters have been killed by low dissolved oxygen content. All this oil in the water column uses up the oxygen, of course, and so down near the
right.
bottom in a lot of these stagnant bays, you know, the oxygen levels just go to zero.
Right. It takes
and the oysters can't survive that.
Right. It takes 3 years from an oyster going from spawning to actually being a harvest size. Craig, I mean, do you worry that people are going to start to say, well, look, this thing hasn't been as bad as folks down in the Gulf were saying it was?
Well, Anderson, you know, any type of disaster, as it gets over its hump, immediately the idea of it's over, claim victory and go away happens as a natural course of disaster response. We have to make sure that we understand that what's happening is, in this part of the disaster, we have an entire culture still at risk. When you hear Dr. Overton talk about 2 to 3 years or even one more season that's lost, that's an entire cultural risk for these fishermen and these commercial families who have been doing this all their lives. So this leads us right to the question of, if we can't have our fishermen who have largely converted to oil spill responders, if they cannot continue to do that and they can't go back to fishing, they are left in no man's land without a claims process that should have long been fixed and being able to take care of these families. Yeah. Otherwise, we're going to have emotional problems, family issues, suicide, drinking, and substance abuse. This is a whole package of issues that is yet to be addressed.
And it'll be 2 or 3 years where folks aren't paying attention elsewhere in the country while the people down there are still not having a livelihood. We got to go. Ed Overton, I appreciate your expertise, and Craig Tufaro Jr. as well. Thank you both very much. Let us